Okay? First of all, I want to talk about having the right understanding, thinking about it properly. There's a spiritual element, we'll talk about that, but the right understanding involves understanding that there's a fundamental problem with weight gain in America and around the world. Researchers at Cornell University studied to demonstrate this, a famous cookbook called The Joy of Cooking. You've all probably heard of that book because it's been in print longer than any other cookbook. All the way, its first printing was back in the 1930s, and it's been in print the whole time. And so they looked at it. They said, well, let's look at some of those early ones, particularly back in the 60s, and they compared it to more current. They found that there's been a 63% increase in portion sizes that are recommended in The Joy of Cooking, because that's what people want now. And so it said, the Cornell researcher said this, these recipes were once intended to serve nearly twice as many people as they do today. So don't let a full portion get anywhere near your plate. So sometimes we focus on fast food eating and eating out, but sometimes it's eating at home is the problem. I mean, if you look at the dinner plates, for example, they've gotten much bigger. If you look at grandma's dinner plate, it looks something more like a cake plate. Today, the plates that are given to newlyweds and recommended for newlyweds, those dinner plates more look like hubcaps. They're big. And then there's kind of this sense, oh, I got to fill that thing up. So what's the secret? Well, there's not a secret to it, actually. It's real simple. It's move more and eat less. That's it. Move more and eat less. Move more. We just got to move around more. Our mantra should be exercise, exercise, exercise. Don't always look to park at the closest spot. And sometimes it's good to park a little ways. Another opportunity to exercise a little bit. Sometimes when I have meetings, I'll ask people. I'll say, hey, do you mind if we just walk around Mount Trashmore? We can still talk. But my day can just be filled with just sitting in front of a desk, talking to people, reading, and I can end up with no exercise day after day after day. So look for opportunities. And now, one of the best things you can do if you're actually looking to trim a few pounds for exercise is just fast walking. Fast walking is one of the best. Just getting your heart rate up 65% faster than its resting heartbeat for about 20, 30 minutes. If you do that 2-3 times a week, it's amazing what happens. You got to carve out the time to do that. But it's really not, we're not talking about, running and jumping and all. We're talking about just fast walking is really the best thing you can do, or one of them. The other thing is eat less. Just eating less makes a big difference. I looked up Christmas gifts on Amazon. I came across this one this week. The world's easiest diet kit. This is one way to eat less. I'm not sure that would really work. I figure we'd get a way around it. But one of the reasons why the French are thinner per capita than Americans, other than the fact that they smoke like chimneys, is that they don't tend to snack like Americans. Americans like to snack a lot. They don't do that. And so snacking, I know some people go, hey, that's part of my diet. Well, if you're eating fruit or vegetables or protein bars, I get it. But if part of your diet is candy and brownies, then that's probably not helping. So, just lowering the calorie count. Another one is just turning off the TV. You go, well, the TV doesn't put on calories. Well, we tend to snack while we eat, while we watch TV, right? Next thing you know, the bag of chips is gone. Where did that go? We're not even paying attention. We're just eating and watching. Also, the advertisers love to push their junk food on TV. And you go, well, that doesn't affect me. Oh, yeah? Why do they spend billions of dollars? Because it works. And they know it works. We don't sometimes even make the connection. We're just shopping. All of a sudden, we just think, I want some Cheetos. I don't know why. But there they are. I might as well get two bags. It's on special. We don't even make the connection that the advertisers kind of got into our brains. Skip sugary drinks and desserts. We can add hundreds of calories that we're not even aware of by just drinking fruit drinks, sugary drinks, those kinds of things. And next thing you know, it's destructive. Avoid strange diets. It's all kinds of diets, right? Diets are everywhere. And we look back and we look and we laugh at some diets that people will be laughing at some of the diets we're doing today. You know, decades from now, they're going to look back. Can you believe they did that kind of diet? Here's a couple strange diets that people were on years back. Back in 1727, a guy named Thomas Short observed people that lived near swamps weighed more. So it's called the avoiding swamp diet. He recommended, if you wanted to, you know, if you live near a swamp, to move. It's called the causes, effects of corpulence. And he said, just move, you know, and it's pretty targeted, right? You have to live near a swamp for it to work. Then there's the tapeworm diet. That was real common in the 20th century. You could go to the doctor and he would give you a prescription to get pills that had tapeworms in it. You could actually ingest an intestinal parasite. And then you can eat even more and still lose weight. You can't get away with that anymore. You know, they've discovered that's probably not the best way to lose weight. There's the cigarette diet. The 1920s, people would, and the doctors would recommend, hey, you get hungry, smoke. And they would recommend, go get some cigarettes. That'll help you lose weight. The Graham diet, this is in 1830, Sylvester Graham, he was a Presbyterian minister. He was one of the first vegetarians, and he believed that people were overweight because they had too much sex. Presbyterian pastor, not Vineyard pastor. He's the guy who created graham crackers that we have on our shelves today. And he believed that if you ate graham crackers, that it would actually reduce your lust factor. So, you know, if your mate gives you some graham crackers, take the hint, right? I'm not sure it works. I don't know if Nabisco wants to capitalize on that. Then there's the vision diet. That's the colors affect your mood and the way, what you desire to eat or how much. So the colors that suppress appetite are gray, black, purple, brown, particularly blue. And then appetite stimulant is orange, green, yellow, turquoise, and particularly red. And that's why you'll see often in restaurants, in the decor, have lots of red in it. Because a lot of people still say, they swear by that. You look at red, you get hungry. So if you're, that's what people do. They just carry a blue card. They get hungry, look at a blue card. Then there's the chewing diet. A guy named Horace Fletcher became known as the great masticator. He lost a stunning 40 pounds because he couldn't get health insurance. That was his motivation. So he lost 40 pounds, and he did it by everything he chewed. He would chew for 32 times and then spit it out. And he lost a lot of weight doing that. His little catchy phrase was, nature will castigate those who don't masticate. Now, we look at them as goes, those are crazy, but all kinds of faddish diets are out there. Only eat grapefruit, never eat starch, never eat sugar, all these kinds of things. It's really not that difficult. It's eat less and move more. And of course, if you eat good things, that's good, but you didn't even have to do that, right? What was that, I guess 2 years ago, the guy, that university professor, decided to eat only Twinkies and see if he could lose weight. He lost weight eating Twinkies and all those kinds of off-the-shelf foods. It's not good for you, but he still lost weight because he made sure and he watched his calorie count. He made sure he moved more, he ate less. Now, looking at the size of the problem is important, both literally and metaphorically. We have an enormous problem of obesity in America, and it has this huge economic correlation that goes with it. The cost has gone through the roof on those things. Did you know that just to drive our cars, we burn nearly a billion gallons of gas more every year than we were if we were the average weight when in the 1960s? It just costs more to try to move us around because we're heavier. Obviously, it's not very environmentally friendly either. Obesity is associated with medical conditions, heart disease, diabetes, chronic pain, knee problems. Obese people tend to be absent from work more than healthy weight people. Obese men average 6 more sick days a year. Obese women average 10 more sick days a year than average weight people. But the real costs, really, from the expanding waistline, is the medical costs. The best studies on the subject say Americans spend $190 billion in additional medical costs as a result of obesity. That's 20.6% higher. So people are saying, hey, you know, medical costs, that's all that's everyone's talking about that, how expensive it is, what are we going to do? 20% of that, according to the best studies, say is result of obesity. It's not just obese people to pay for that, but everybody has to pay for that through their taxes and Medicare and Medicaid. And it's thousands of dollars more every year that people are paying for that. And so it's a big problem. But it's not just a problem with our health. There's also a spiritual element. You know, it's now the leading cause over cigarette smoking. That's the leading expense in health in healthcare expenses. It's public health enemy number one. But as Christ followers, there's also another aspect. There is the value of the body. The value of the body. Some of you might even be thinking, well, why are we even talking about this? I get enough of this from the world. This doesn't sound very spiritual. I mean, we were just in a 3-week prayer series. Why not just add another week? Do 4 weeks. Maybe I'll learn how to pray after 4 weeks. I mean, why not let's do something on worship or studying the Bible? And we do that. We cycle around and make sure and talk about those because those are discipleship issues. But here's the thing, folks, that this also is a discipleship issue. It's God gave us our bodies, and he expects us to steward them. And so it's part of the way that we live out our Christian faith. It's part of our testimony, whether we like it or not. The Bible talks a lot about it. If you're a student of the Bible, you know that there's many, many verses that talk about the importance of the body, how we're to steward our body, and that God honors the human body in many ways. Let me give you some. First of all, God created your body and inhabits your body if you're a believer in Christ. The Apostle Paul said, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? How did you receive it from God? Well, when you put your faith in Christ and we invite Jesus into our lives, he literally takes us on our word and comes into our lives. Christ's spirit dwells in us. He says, you are not of your own. You were bought at a price. So that's incredible value. God also came to earth in a body. He hallows the body. So he came and dwelled in the body when he was here on earth. 1 Timothy 3:16 says, beyond all question, the mystery from which true godliness springs is great. He appeared in a body, was vindicated by the Spirit, was seen by angels, was preached among the nations, was believed on in the world, and was taken up in glory. So our eternal state is not this this soul that floats around in heaven. We're going to have a body in heaven. Now here's the good news. If you don't like your body, you're going to get a new body in heaven, and we'll be on a new earth. But God, we're not like the angels that have no body. We actually have a body. We have a body here. God expects us to steward, and we will also have a body that we're given in heaven. It's not just Christianity is not just learning a bunch of Bible knowledge. That's important. But if we ignore our body and we're just all interested in the head, we're like a bobblehead, right? It's out of balance. Listen to some of these verses there in 1 Thessalonians. It says, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then 1 Corinthians 7:1 says, therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. And so we honor God with how we treat our bodies, what we eat, what we drink, whether we exercise or not, all those things. When we eat less, when we move more, that is a way of honoring God. Then there's also the right motive. The right motive is important. And there's a lot of good reasons to get in shape. First of all, there's physical reasons. Harvard School of Public Health listed some reasons that are positive physical reasons for exercise. Here's some of them. They say being active improves your chances of living longer and living healthier. Helps protect you from developing heart disease and stroke. Helps protect you from developing certain cancers, including colon and breast cancer. Helps prevent type 2 diabetes. Helps prevent the bone loss known as osteoporosis. Reduces the risk of falling and improves cognitive function among older adults. Relieves symptoms of depression and anxiety and improves mood. Prevents weight gain. Promotes weight loss. Improves sleep. There's some physical things that help us out when we start to take care of our body. Now, when I first got into the ministry, everybody I knew, all the pastors I knew, were overweight. And so I just figured that's part of the package. I'm going to be overweight. So I went to get my first suit, which I don't really wear a lot of suits. I'm in the Vineyard, right? So I wear them from time to time. So when I went to get my first suit, I told the guy, I'm probably going to gain weight. I'm a pastor. So I need a suit that's got it's ready for that. It's got I can come in every couple of years and I'll expand in it. And so I bought one that had all this extra fabric in it. And that's what I did. Every couple of years, I'd come in, I'm back, Yep, you are. And he'd widen it a little bigger. I was down during the Promise Keepers movement. They had a clergy meeting in Atlanta, Georgia. And they invited all the clergy throughout the United States to come. And so a lot of them did come. And thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of pastors all flew in. I was there in my little rental car at a crosswalk. The Georgia Dome was to my right. And I was watching I was looking for a parking place. And I was watching all these pastors. I knew they were pastors, mainly because they're going to the Georgia Dome. And it's all flooding in. And then walking the other way towards the business district was all these business people. And they were thin. And all of the pastors looked like Friar Tucks walking. And I thought to myself, it was just like, I remember that contrast thinking, oh, wow, that's my profession. Well, I'm proud of my group, That wasn't enough to change me, though. It wasn't until I got very sick. I got incredibly sick. I had different medical problems. The worst was my asthma. I was so sick. I was getting medical attention, but I was at home. And I was 30 pounds heavier than I am today. And I know that contributed. I know there's other things that go into it, but I was a mess. I mean, I'm sitting in this recliner that I drug into the living room because I couldn't move around the house. I mean, I would go to the bathroom and come back and I would have a coughing spasm for 10, 15 minutes, gasping for breath. If you have asthma, you know how that feels, where you just feel like you're drowning. And this went on for weeks. And I just thought, I'm not very productive. And this isn't very good, and I haven't stewarded my body, and something's got to change. And so that, for me, was my wake-up call. I hope that wouldn't have to happen to you. But maybe it will. I had somebody come up to me right before the service, and she goes, Andy, I want you to know that my sister heard you talk about when you got cancer in your face. And she went home and immediately, just because of what I had said, went and had her face checked. Turns out she had the same cancer and had it removed. And I said, hey, that's awesome. That my story, my pain can be used for somebody else's benefit. I'm glad for that. I would hope the same thing right now for you. That you wouldn't have to wait till you're sick. And I was in a meeting about 2 years ago here at the church. I'd gathered together some men. It was, I guess, about 10, 12 men. We were in a room and we were talking. This issue came up somehow. I don't remember why. And it kind of came up with a diabetes. And I said, diabetes could end up being the result. And somebody said, yeah, I have diabetes. And then somebody else said, I did. I said, really? It turns out everybody in the room but one, other than me, had diabetes. That's terrible, folks. I would be remiss if I didn't get up and share. And I don't harp on this every week, obviously. But it's part of our spiritual duty to honor God with our body so we're just not just in a heap at the end of our years. We need to take this seriously and say, you know what? I want to do my best for the Lord. That's part of our motive. Now, this book called Everybody Matters, terrific book. I would recommend it. The author, Gary Thomas, makes this parody from Proverbs. So let me read the proverb for you, and then I'll read the parody. He said, I went past the field of a slugger, past the field of someone who has no sense. Thorns had come up everywhere. The ground was covered with weeds, and the stone wall was in ruins. I applied my heart to what I observed and learned a lesson from what I saw. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief and scarcity like an armed man. Now here's Gary Thomas's parody on that verse. I went past the body of a sluggard, past the body of someone who has no sense. His cholesterol was killing him from within. His high blood pressure was a tinderbox waiting to explode. His breath was labored, and he could barely move without breaking into a sweat. He said he had no time to exercise and to prepare healthy meals, but he lost hours going to the doctor and much money buying medicines to treat the symptoms rather than attack the disease. I applied my heart to what I observed and learned a lesson from what I saw: a little sleep, a little softness, a life of overindulgence, and ill health will come on you like a thief, and frailty like an armed man. So there's physical reasons. There's also emotional reasons to maintain a healthy weight. You feel better about yourself. Your life as a Christ follower is congruent with how you're living out your life. Have you ever ordered a meal? You're out. Have you ever noticed a lot of times fun food is not very good food for you, right? If you're, let's have some fun, you know, yeah, let's order a tray of broccoli. Oh, that's awesome. Nobody does that, right? No, it's fries and cheese and bacon bits. People are happy now. You know, that's happy food is usually food that's not very good for you. So you order some happy food. And it's there, it's sizzling, it's bubbling with the grease. And then if you pray for food, have you ever tried to pray for a meal like that? It's hard, right? It's kind of like, what's the way to pray for this? You know, thank you for make this nutritious to my body doesn't come to mind, right? So it's still good food, and I do it from time to time. But it's incongruent. You feel better when it's congruent, when your prayers match your behaviors. And that is true with how we steward our bodies. That when the way God wants us to live our life out, we feel better about ourselves. We feel better when we honor God. Paul says, you were bought at a price, the price that Jesus Christ paid on the cross for us. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. So there's emotional reasons to get in shape. Again, from the book, Every Body Matters, Gary Thomas talks about a woman, true story, named Karen. She had two little kids of her own, and then she adopted a third child from Ethiopia. Here's what he said. He said, she suddenly had three little kids to care for. She had put on weight from her pregnancies and just taking care of fussy babies and being tired. She found herself over the course of 5 years increasingly getting out of shape. Here's what Karen said. She goes, I looked in the mirror and didn't think I looked very attractive anymore. I didn't feel noticed. I didn't feel very beautiful with Curtis, her husband. I was no longer his girlfriend. I was his frumpy wife and the mother of his kids. It's not that he made me feel that way. I felt it all on my own. And then Karen said, the worse I felt, the worse I did with my devotions, the less initiating I was with my husband, and the less energetic I was around the kids. And then Gary Thomas goes on. He says, what snapped her out of all this was when Karen started playing volleyball again. She once had been a really good athlete in high school, and she started going to the gym. Even though she was really rusty and getting involved in with some other women and being away from the kids, not thinking about dishes and groceries and runny noses, but physically engaging her body improved her overall outlook on life. And her physical movements also improved her self-image, lifted some of the shame she had felt about herself, increased her energy for God and for her family. And we certainly should not stop taking care of our bodies just because we get married. That's not honoring to the people that we're married to. The psalmist celebrates the wife who says to her husband, you are more handsome than any other. And the husband that says he delights in her beauty. Now, the person you married, you say, well, isn't this, you know, worldly? No, he married you because he liked the way you look. You don't have to look like somebody else. You don't have to look like a movie star, somebody out of a magazine. You don't have to look like some beauty queen. But it is worth taking the pains to look like the person he married and fell in love with, and vice versa. You know, the Bible says that when we get married, we have new responsibilities about our body. We don't just live for ourselves. We live for the other person. And the other person has emotional needs as well. 1 Corinthians 7:4 says, the wife does not have authority over her body, but yields it to her husband. In the same way, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but yields it to his wife. And so part of the benefits of maintaining a healthy weight is not just physical, but emotional. It helps our own self-esteem. It also helps our relationship with our spouse. Then there's spiritual reasons. Spiritual reasons are probably more important than all of them. I mean, there's emotional ones and physical ones, but ultimately the spiritual reason is love. In other words, if I steward my body well, I can love God and love other people, my family, my friends, my coworkers, and so forth, better. Now, let me just say this. If you, over the next several months, over the holiday season, the average American gains 10 pounds over a holiday season. If you gain 10 pounds over these between now and January 1st, God will not love you any less. Okay? And if you drop 10 pounds, God will not love you anymore. We're not talking about God's love for you. That's unconditional. We're talking about your being able to love God and other people. And God gave you a body. That's part of the way we function and minister and do good things. And anything that we're going to do, we use our body. And we're able to love God through our body more. It'll improve our energy level and all those kinds of things. 1 Timothy 4 says, have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present and the life to come. That word, train yourself, is the Greek word gymnase. It's where we get our word gymnasium. So he's saying when you go to the gym, there's benefits, but it also affects the spiritual domain as well. And if you're a student of the Bible, you see this, particularly a student of the New Testament. You see this connection. Paul's always making this metaphor about physical exercise and disciplining his body and how it helps with our spiritual life. He's always making those connections. Now, he specifically kind of ties in to some of the games that they were involved in, the Olympic Games, for example, every 4 years. That they would do those. And then in Corinth specifically, they had additional games. They had the Isthmian games, which were involved boxing and jumping, horseback riding, a number of different running, different types of events. And here's what Paul says. He says, do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified. So he's tying into some of the games. They did boxing as well. And he's saying, just like we grow in discipline in those areas, those are the same things. And he makes that connection. Paul's saying there's a carryover. He says, do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? He says, hey, we're running for a prize too. But you learn, just as you learn that in the area of exercise, we can carry that over to what we do spiritually. Athletes engage in intense competition, right? And he says that not everybody gets that prize. He goes, we're going for a prize from the Lord Jesus Christ. And athletes also learn delayed gratification. He says everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They go and do it for a crown that will not last, but we do it for a crown that will last forever. Christians can learn from exercise and self-discipline, saying no to ourselves and being willing to wait to reap great rewards. The very same motivations and mechanisms that we need to do what we're doing, what we're talking about spiritually, we do those in the physical domain. What makes us think we can really like crush it in one area, but then not in another? They're connected. We are connected. And athletes have a goal they set out before them. And he says, we too have goals set out. We have physical goals. We have spiritual goals. And so that is an important part. He says, make the connection there. That when you go to the gym, it's a spiritual thing because we're learning those same disciplines. We're learning those same goal setting and the ability to support one another, which is number three, right support. You see, it's more than just intellect. Most of us here know that, like that sandwich that was on the video earlier, that's probably not the best thing for you, right? I mean, most of us know we've got it. But we don't do it because it's not, it's just an issue of intellect. Part of the, when we want to do something, like if we do set a goal, like, hey, I want to just maintain my weight throughout the holidays, there's an opposer. There's a pushback that each one of us get. And that's, his name is Satan. There's spiritual principalities, darkness, that tries to push against us. That's why we rally together. That's why Christianity, we're called to come together as a church and in small groups. We rally together because that's how we overcome this opposing force. I like the way that Gary Thomas puts it in his book. He says this: Satan may attempt to ruin one man's ministry by luring him into a financial trap that will ultimately become a crime and thus wreck his business and his reputation. He may attempt to ruin a woman by gradually filling her mind with thoughts of fantasy towards a coworker and thoughts of malice towards her husband so that she is weakened and enters into an immoral affair. And he may get others to eat one too many bacon cheeseburgers without any corresponding exercise and take them out of the way. He doesn't care what brings our ministry to an end. He just wants it to end. If Satan can't keep you from getting saved, he wants to make sure you are useless as a Christian. And one way is by attacking your body so that you are not physically able to do what God may be calling you to do. What if it's God's will that you live and serve him vigorously until age 90 or beyond? What if it's God's will that you live and be able to love and serve not only your kids, but your grandkids and great-grandkids? Bad stewardship of your body and decades of bad choices regarding eating too much and moving too little render you unable to vigorously serve God well into your old age and vigorously serve your family, your friends, the church, and the world well into your old age. And so none of us really are able to do it alone. It takes a group. Who you hang out with, who you connect with. Proverbs 12:26 says, the righteous choose their friends carefully. Now, parents would say that to our kids, choose your friends carefully. That's good advice. It's good advice for ourselves as well. Choose our friends carefully, because the number one indicator of whether you and I will be successful in maintaining our weight and honoring God with our body is our closest friends that we allow in. You know, our family, our friends, maybe the five closest ones. They're the ones, because you know how hard it is if your closest friends don't have that as a shared value. That's very, very difficult, nearly impossible. And so you make sure and surround yourself with people that have shared value of stewarding their body, of honoring God with their body. Proverbs 13:20 says, walk with the wise and become wise. Associate with fools and get into trouble. We do have small groups. We do have ways to get connected. And here's one way that I'm gonna invite you to consider. I discovered an app that I have really liked. It's called Lose It. Okay, it's a free app. Now, if you already have an app you're using, go ahead and use that. That's awesome. Or maybe you're doing fine. You don't need, you know, something like this. But I invite you to invite this app down. I really have enjoyed it. It's super easy to use, and I don't adapt to new apps very easy. But I downloaded it. It was easy to use. It ties into my GPS. So if I'm at a restaurant, it says, I know you're at this restaurant. What did you just order? And then it comes up with the menu. The menu's right there. Well, that's what I got. And if I'm eating at home, almost everything has one of those little barcodes on it. All I do is just flash it. It instantly says, okay, and it registers it in there. It remembers, because we tend to eat a lot of the same stuff, and it's just very easy to do. You can also invite, it's kind of a social media thing, you can invite other friends to be part of it. Now, they won't be able to see your menu, which I think is good for me. I don't want people looking at it. Ah. Two glasses of wine, huh, Andy? Or more. No, I'm just kidding. I don't want people looking into my life like that. You probably don't want that. But it does share your goals, some of the things that you kind of set out, your objectives. You can give support for one another. And so maybe that's something that would be helpful for you. I encourage you to, you know, consider something like that. Listen, we're in this, you know, we have an epidemic, as I pointed out. It's all around us. We can stand apart together, but we can say, you know what? Those are the world's values, really. The truth is stewarding our body, honor God with our body. That's Christian discipleship. So no excuses. We're not going to pretend that's not an issue. It is. And so we're going to commit together and say, you know what, let's do this. We're not going to get all caught up in guilt. See, God's love for us is unconditional. So if we mess up, we just move on. The Bible says that his mercy and grace is new every day. Every day we get a fresh start. I love that verse. Okay, let's stand up and we'll close in prayer. Well, I think of the verse that says, weep with those who weep, rejoice with those who are rejoicing. Those who are weak, those who are strong, stand by them. You know, that's my dream for the Vineyard Community Church, particularly on a subject like this. This is the third time I've spoken this message, and people that are struggling kind of just, you know, they go and they don't see me. People that are doing well, they're all giving me high fives. That's not what I want. You don't need to give me a high five if this is, I'm just preaching to the choir. But you know what I would like you to do is maybe support somebody else. I don't need the high five. Maybe you could be praying for somebody who's struggling. And maybe, you know what, you're not doing so well in some areas. Maybe you need somebody that they're crushing it in their devotions or something else, and you need prayer. So let's be careful not to fall into, you know, thinking we're better than people. I'm not saying that's what people thought. I'm telling you, we need one another. Amen. So this might be an area you're doing great at. Praise God for you. But don't just walk out of here saying, well, I got that one crushed. No. You can help other people, just like you need help in certain areas. Okay? Let's pray. Father, help us to be a body that stands together. And wherever one of us falls down, the other will come and support us. Lord, I pray against condemnation and guilt, like always. This isn't the first issue that we've covered that can make us feel that way. But every time we pray the same prayer, that we know that you declare that condemnation is not from you. And so, Lord, we know that's from the enemy. And so the accuser of the brethren, we just speak against that and say, no, there's no condemning. There's no feeling guilty and all that stuff here. That's going down the wrong road. Lord, teach us to just bathe in your love, to know we're accepted regardless of what we do, and that you love us right where we're at, but you also love us into new areas of change. Lord, you say that you want to transform us. So I invite you right now to give God permission. Say, God, transform the way I think about things. Transform the way I think about my body. That was a pretty challenging word for married couples. Say, God, transform me, Lord. Teach me how to operate in this area that without your help, I will fail. You invite God's power. Say, God, fill me with your power. Fill me with your strength. And would you invite other people and say, God, I want to invite us people around me that will encourage me and support me. Call me out. Call me up. If you've never put your faith in Christ, that's the beginning point. Your body's not even a temple of the Holy Spirit yet. Why not invite Christ into your life? Say, Jesus Christ, come into my life. Empower me and begin that process of transforming my mind, seeing things the way you see them. Say, Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of my sin, of my wrongdoing, and give me a new, fresh start. In Jesus' name, amen.